Hi friends, welcome to Beautifully Bookish Bethany. Today's video is my July reading wrap-up. So in July, I actually ended up reading a lot. Was this partly because I had a sinus infection the entire month, and I am still trying to figure out what's going on with the sinus infection and seeing doctors? Yes, possibly. So I did do a lot of reading, and we're going to cover all of the things. If you're new to my end of month wrap-ups, the way that these work is I start by talking about all of my reading stats for the month. I am a stats nerd. I enjoy this part of the video. Some of y'all do as well. But if you are not interested in all of the stats, you're more than welcome to skip forward to the part where I start actually reviewing the books. Then I'm going to talk about all the books that I read this month, starting with my DNFs or books I didn't finish, my lowest rated books, and move up to my highest rated books. Some of these books I did talk about in more detail in my mid-month wrap-up. So for those books, I will let you know the book and the star rating, but I'm going to direct you to my mid-month wrap-up, which is linked up above if you want to go and hear more. Overall, I would say it was a pretty good reading month. I liked the majority of the things that I was reading, and we've got a lot of variety. With that said, let's go ahead and jump into my reading stats for July. In July, I read 40 things. Which sounds like a lot, but keep in mind this does include a graphic novel and some short stories, so not all of these things are lengthy, although I have some lengthy books as well. It's kind of a mix. This is a total of 11,015 pages, which is a page count of 355 pages per day. That is pretty typical for me in a month that's not super busy. I think it's a little on the high end for a summer month. The reason I think it's more than usual is, again, because I've been kind of sick and probably reading more as a result. 19 of the books that I read this month were ARCs or advanced reader copies or books that I had for review. I DNF'd one book, we'll talk about that, or did not finish it. I read one graphic novel, 7 indie books, one translated book, and had one reread. I also listened to a lot of audiobooks. Probably nobody is surprised. 28 of the books that I read this month were on audio. This includes a lot of short stories, which again, I feel like that number's kind of inflated because this four or five of those are just like short stories on audio. So anyway. I also read 5 physical books and 7 ebooks. Taking a closer look at those audiobooks, 14 of them are what I term shelf, which means that I owned a physical copy and got it off my TBR through audio or primarily through audio. And in terms of where those audiobooks are coming from, this month 12 of them were from Audible. That includes like the 5 short stories that were free. One of them was from Chirp. 6 of them were from Libre.fm. This does include some audio influencer copies, and I do love Libre.fm. Highly recommend you go and check them out, especially because they just went international. So for those of you who are, like, this is very exciting news. I have a link down below that you can use to go and sign up and join their program. I love them because they're a small business owned by the employees, and a lot of their proceeds go to support local indie bookstores. It's great if you want an alternative to Audible. And like I said, they just went international, so now anybody is welcome to use Libre.fm. That's very exciting. So yeah, 6 from Libre.fm. 6 of them were audio review copies from NetGalley, and 3 of them were from Scribd. So we had kind of a wide range this month. In terms of target audience, I was reading primarily books for adults. No big surprise there. 32 of the books that I read were targeted at an adult audience. 6 of them were YA, and 2 of them were middle grade. Next, let's take a look at publication date. In July, the earliest published work that I read was from 1920, and in total, I read 15 books that were published prior to 2022. So that's pretty good in terms of backlist. I read a lot of backlist this month, which is great. I read one book published in 2022 and 23 books published in 2023. Author demographics are also looking good this month. I really value reading diversely and reading books from marginalized authors. So every month, I aim to read at least 25% from openly queer authors and around 50% from Black, Indigenous, and person of color authors. I hit both of those benchmarks in July. 25% of the books that I read were by authors who are openly members of the LGBT plus community, and 50% of the books that I read were by Black, Indigenous, or person of color authors. So, nailed it. Love it. And checking my stats every month helps keep me accountable to make sure that I am hitting those goals that are really important to me. Next up is genre. I told you we have a wide range this month, but most of this is not going to be super surprising. In July, I read 11 fantasy books, 8 sci-fi, 8 romance, and that includes 1 historical romance, 5 contemporary romances, and 2 speculative romances. Your speculative is going to be your sci-fi, fantasy, or paranormal romance. I also read 4 horror books, 3 thrillers, 2 mysteries, 2 general nonfiction, 1 contemporary fiction, and 1 memoir. So we actually had 3 nonfiction books this month, which is unusual, so I'm not mad about it. And more than usual, mystery thrillers. I think because in July, that's kind of what I want to read. More so than other times of the year, I would say. Next, let's take a look at my star ratings for the month. Like I said, I did like the majority of what I read, but I think it does skew a little lower than last month. This month I gave 1 book 1 star. I did not give out any 1.5 stars. 1 book got 2 stars. 2 books got 2.5 stars. 3 books got 3 stars. 3 books got 3.5 stars. 13 books got 4 stars. As usual, this is my most commonly given rating. 5 books got 4.5 stars. 10 books got 5 stars, and 1 book got 6 stars. And in my personal rating scale, a 6-star read is a favorite of the year. So one of those this month, and my average rating for July was 4.0, which is pretty good. Again, not as amazing as last month, but still very respectable. Lastly, we'll take a quick peek at my yearly challenges. There has not been any change to these since last month. Which I'm not surprised. Summer months are difficult for me to complete these kinds of challenges. I expect that I will get more into them in the fall, but currently I've read 2 out of the 5 books on my classics TBR, 2 out of the 5 books on my sci-fi fantasy TBR, 4 out of the 6 books on my nonfiction TBR, and all 6 of the books on my Star Wars TBR for 2023. So those are the stats. With that said, let's go ahead and move into talking about all of the books that I read in July. I will begin with my 1 DNF. So the book that I DNF'd, I'm kind of bummed because on paper it sounded like something I would really love, but alas, it did not work for me. That is The Woman in the Castello by Kelsey James. And I kept reading this for a while, trying to make up my mind because I kept thinking it would get better. I made it more than halfway into this book before I finally was like, nope, I can't. This is set in the 1960s in Italy, and it's supposed to be kind of a gothic thriller with a creepy old castle. I just found the plot very slow. Not much happened in the first 50% of the book. It started to pick up a little bit, but the main character was so annoying. She's a full-grown woman, she's a single mom, and she makes so many stupid choices and also does things that just felt a little bit absurd to me as somebody who's trying to make it as an actress. I was like, really? That's what you're gonna do? That's your choice? And then there was some kind of weird use of like Nazis. I don't know. I ended up going at the 50% mark and reading some Goodreads reviews to see sort of where the story goes and whether it would be worth it for me to continue. And based on what I was seeing, I was like, no, I don't even like where this is gonna go. I'm just gonna call it quits. So had high hopes, but unfortunately this book just didn't work for me. But you know, your mileage may vary. Some readers seem to be enjoying it. It just wasn't my cup of tea. This month I gave 1 book 1 star, and I don't know, like maybe that I'm being a little hard on this book, but I was just so annoyed with it by the end that I decided to give it 1 star. This is The Cask by Freeman Wills Crofts. Freeman, did I get that right? Hold on. Yes, Freeman Wills Crofts. This I read for the Blades and Bodice Rippers book club, and we have a whole discussion about it over on Mara's channel. This is a quarterly book club that we do, which is pretty fun. And this was Mara's pick, so she picked something from the golden age of detective fiction. And it was not a hit for me. I found it to be really tedious. It was not a hit for me. That said, everybody else liked it okay. It was like around a 3-star read for everybody else, and I was just so annoyed with it. I found it to be really tedious. It felt like the author didn't trust the reader to make any logical leaps, and it was so repetitive. And then on top of that, the treatment of women wasn't great. I mean, what am I expecting? It's from the 1920s, but like there are female detectives and the only thing that they're tasked with is figuring out where the victim of the murder mystery bought her clothes, and they can't even do that competently, and the men have to take over and do it for them. I don't know. I think I was so annoyed by the ending that what maybe I could have taken as campy, I just found irritating. It probably didn't help that I listened to this on audio. I bought the audiobook from Libro FM, and I didn't realize until after I purchased it that it's an AI audiobook, which is really weird. I don't know if you've ever listened to an AI audiobook, but like it's a very strange experience. So I'm sure that didn't help. and my irritation. Just by the end of it, I was like, one star. I don't like it. But that said, I can see the argument for how this could be really fun as, say, a film adaptation where it could be kind of campy and silly and over the top. I would much rather watch the movie than read the book. I don't think this era of detective fiction is for me, but the other ladies in book club enjoyed it much more than I did. So, oh, and our haunted ring light is back, probably because of the heat. Maybe I should turn the air conditioner on. Let's do that. Moving right along, this month I gave one book 2 stars, and I did talk about that book in my mid-month wrap-up, so I'm going to direct you there if you want to hear my thoughts. That book is The Frugal Wizard's Handbook for Surviving Medieval England by Brandon Sanderson. Wasn't the biggest fan of this, but it's another one where I really think people's experiences are going to be pretty variable. Then I had 2 books that I gave 2.5 stars, and I have not talked about either of them. One of them is the first of those short stories I mentioned. Amazon sometimes works with well-known authors to create stories on a theme and releases them as a collection, and they just did a sci-fi one. So because I'm an Amazon Prime member, I was able to access the audiobooks for free, which was really nice. So I listened to 5 out of the 6, I think, so you're gonna see my thoughts on all of them. The first one I wasn't the biggest fan of. It was okay. This was The Long Game by Anne Leckie. I've never read from Anne Leckie before. I know she's really popular, and I thought, well, maybe this will be an interesting taste test. I don't know if this is a great example of her writing. It wasn't my favorite. It was fine. Basically, this follows a very small sentient creature from another planet that is discovered by humans, and it has a very short lifespan, and it realizes that humans live much longer. I don't know. It was fine. I don't know that I have even much to say about it, but 2.5 stars. I didn't hate it, but I didn't particularly like it either. The other 2.5 star read is a little bit of a disappointment, and I think this was actually officially on my August TBR, but I read it at the end of July instead. This is the first book I've read from this author that I didn't love. We'll talk about why. This is Masters of Death by Olivia Blake, the author of The Atlas Six. I have really enjoyed everything else I've read from Olivia Blake. This is one of her backlist titles that they picked up, and it has a lot going for it. I like the premise. It's really fun and quirky, and the characters are fun and quirky. It follows a vampire real estate agent who's trying to sell a house, but there is a ghost haunting it, and she needs to get rid of the ghost. So she hires this fake medium who can't really see ghosts, but is the godson of death, and that's how he does his thing. And then there's like a whole cast of other side characters, and they get drawn into this philosophical game of the gods, and there are like corrupt angels, and I don't know. Like, I like the concept, I like the characters, I just thought this was too long and too convoluted for the kind of book that it is. And maybe I shouldn't be surprised. Most of her books have lots of different perspectives and maybe different timelines and have a lot going on. And the people who don't like Olivia Blake's other books tend to say they feel overwritten to them or feel like they're too convoluted and there's too much going on. Normally, that doesn't bother me, but I think for a book with this kind of a humorous, campy tone, I want the plotting and the pacing to be a little bit snappier. So I just think that the ideas in here were good, but the way Olivia Blake writes mixed with this tone of a book didn't work as well for me. I hope that makes sense. Again, some people, that won't bother them and they'll still really enjoy this. This was another one that was fine. I didn't hate it, but I didn't love it either in the way that I have some of her other books. So. It's a bummer because it's a really pretty book. Tor sent me a copy, and like the end papers, oh my gosh, and there's like illustrations all through the book, but it's really pretty. Alas, this was not a win for me, but I will read whatever else she puts out because generally I like her stuff. Moving on, let's talk about my 3-star reads. This month there were 3 of them, and one of them I talked about in my mid-month wrap-up. That book was The Front Porch Club by Michelle Major. If you want to hear thoughts on this, go check out that video. I also gave 3 stars to How It Unfolds by James S.A. Corey. This is another one of those short stories from the anthology. I liked this pretty well. I want to try their series. I have been interested in the Expanse series, but I haven't actually read it. What did I say about this? It didn't stick with me, clearly. So she's probably why I gave it like 3 stars. What was this one about? Okay. I do remember what this one about. So this was an interesting concept. It's kind of a post-apocalyptic thing. It's about these people who create many cloned copies of themselves that will unfold at different points in the future. And along the way, it follows a man and his ex-wife and kind of explores, like, could their relationship ever have worked out, or could things have gone differently in all these other lifetimes? I liked it. It didn't leave much of an impact on me, but I liked it. It was interesting. And my final 3-star read was The Legacies by Jessica Goodman. I was kindly sent a copy of this from Penguin Teen, so thank you to them. I liked this. It's fun. It's soapy. It's kind of like Gossip Girl plus murder mystery vibes. That's generally what you're gonna get from this. I keep chasing the high of Jessica Goodman's second book, with They'll Never Catch Us, I think is what it's called, because I loved it so much. And every other book that I've read from her, I've liked. You know, they're fun YA summery thrillers and mysteries with lots of drama and messiness, and this book is no different. I am gonna give a big content warning on this one, though, for addiction issues. One of the perspective characters is an addict but doesn't realize she's an addict just yet, and that gets pretty intense. So if you have issues with reading addiction, like, maybe steer clear of this one. But yeah, I liked this one. It was fun. It was interesting. It's got multiple perspectives, some insider, some outsider. There's this elite club called The Legacies that all of these high school students are joining, and one of them didn't grow up with money, the others did, but someone has died at the ball in the future, and then it's going back to trace, like, who died and why did they die and what happened. Gossip Girl plus murder. So if that sounds fun, go check it out. All right, next up, let's take a look at my 3.5-star reads. This month there were 3 of them, and one of them I talked about in my mid-month wrap-up. That book is The Marriage He Demands by Brenda Jackson. If you want to hear about that, go check out my mid-month wrap-up. I also gave 3 stars to A Guide to the Dark by Miriam Matwee. This is a debut YA paranormal book, and I liked it. I don't know that it was quite what I was expecting, and I think I wanted a little bit more from parts of it, but I think it's a pretty solid debut, and there was a lot that I liked about it. It's a sapphic novel. It follows 2 girls who are best friends, and both of them secretly have crushes on each other. One of them is out as bisexual, and the other one is closeted even to herself, and they are going on a road trip to visit colleges at the beginning of the book when their car breaks down outside this small town, and they have to wait for it to get fixed. And meanwhile, they check into this motel and are put in this room that is known for possibly being haunted because a lot of people have died in that motel room. And it is a book about grief. One of the girls has recently lost her younger brother and feels a lot of guilt about that. And so part of this is an exploration of grief. It's also an exploration of the challenges of coming out to yourself and to other people, especially when you are from a culture and a family that may have a hard time with it. One thing that's interesting is that both of the main characters are from Muslim immigrant families, although from different places. And I think that's kind of cool because you sort of see the distinct cultural identities that each of them have and kind of their relationship. I think the thing is that this book was trying to do so many things, it didn't give me everything that I wanted. So I think it spent a lot more time on the grief and the paranormal stuff. And so because of that, I didn't feel like we got enough of the romantic plot arc, and it felt like it came together a little bit too quickly. But overall, a very strong debut novel. I think it's worth checking out, and I would read more from this author in the future. My final 3.5-star read is True True by Dawn J. Hooper. This is a YA contemporary novel about a Black teen boy from Brooklyn who moves in his senior year to a almost all-white elite prep school in Manhattan and faces a lot of racism and microaggressions, and is also dealing with a lot of stuff at home. He's got a dad who had to go back to Jamaica and is trying to work on immigration stuff. He's just juggling a lot and has a lot of pressure on him, and then is trying to figure out how to stand up for his cohort of fellow Black students at the new school that he's going to. I liked this. I don't think I realized when I when I took this as an advanced copy that it was going to be so YA. I hope you know what I mean. I don't read a lot of straight up YA contemporary books unless they have a little bit of something more to it thematically. And this has a lot going on, but it feels very for teenagers. And that's not a bad thing. I think that is a great thing for the right audience for this book. But I wasn't expecting it to be so young and so YA. I think I struggled a bit personally to enjoy it, but I still gave it 3.5 stars and I rounded up to 4 on Goodreads because I think for the audience it's trying to reach, it's good. It's got a lot of good stuff that it's saying, and it's a debut novel, so if that sounds like something that would be up your alley or something that would be good for people in your life, go check it out. Next is my 4-star reads. I had a lot of them. This was my most given one. I want to say there were like 13 of them, if I'm not mistaken, and 6 of them I talked about in my mid-month wrap-up. Okay. Those books are A Song of Salvation by Alicia Dow, Dark Corners by Megan Golden, Empire of Wiles by Cherie Demoline, Green-Eyed Monster by Elsie Winters, Radiant Sin by Katie Robert, and we also have a Chapter 3 podcast episode discussing this one, and Wrong Place, Wrong Time by Jillian McAllister. So if you want to hear about any of those, go check out my mid-month wrap-up. I also gave 4 stars to Destiny's Embrace by Beverly Jenkins. I really like Beverly Jenkins. This is one of her slightly older books. I mean, you know, not super old, but a little bit. And it's a historical romance following two Black characters in the American West. This is a book that on paper, I shouldn't have enjoyed as much as I did. It has a lot of things that usually make it hard for me to enjoy a historical romance. And so I'm going to put this caveat out there, even though I did really enjoy it. I really enjoyed the dynamic between the characters. I loved the heroine. I liked them getting together. However, he is high-handed. They have kind of a toxic relationship. There is some fuzzy consent where he pushes past her boundaries. And it's that thing of like, okay, but she really does want it, but she said she didn't. And I mean, there's like kind of consent, but it's fuzzy. There's places where it's a little fuzzy. Usually that will make me not enjoy a book. For whatever reason, in this case, I did enjoy it. And so this follows a young woman who has been raised by an abusive mom who runs away to answer an ad for a housekeeper somewhere else. And she lies and says that she's a widow, even though she is not, but she's like 30-ish. And the hero is the guy that she is working for. So also he's her employer. You know, it's complicated, but then he's got like this great woman who is his stepmother, who is Spanish, and she kind of like, I don't know. It's fun because the heroine like really puts him in his place. He's never had a girl say no to him, and I enjoyed it. I enjoyed their dynamic. I know there are problems with it, but I really enjoyed it, and I liked the historical element of it. So do with that what you will. It was a 4-star read for me. I also gave 4 stars to Falling Bodies by Rebecca Roanhorse. This is another one of those sci-fi short stories. And I thought this one was really interesting, especially if you read it in the context that I think is intended, which is that of the forced removal of Indigenous children from their families and their adoption by white families. I think this story has a lot of subtext if you think about it in that context. So this follows a main character who was adopted by aliens who have come to Earth and kind of taken over. And at one point he was kidnapped or rescued by a rebel group. He has a very complicated relationship with his adoptive father, and it's kind of dark, but I liked this. I thought it was a good short story. I thought she did a good job, and there are some interesting things she's exploring. I also give 4 stars to More to Love by Georgina Kirsten. This was adorable. If you're looking for a quick read, a novella that is both sweet and steamy and super queer and diverse, I think this is a fantastic option. It's a male-male romance written by a trans-masc non-binary Black author. And we've got two main characters. One of them is bisexual and Korean and fat. So we've got some really great fat representation in this. And the other one is a queer black man who owns a bookstore. Also, the Korean guy likes reading romances, which is cute. So they have a meet cute at a bookstore. They have this little romance that develops and it's super cute and really sweet, but also steamy. And I very much enjoyed it. I think this is well worth a read. It is self-published, so if you're looking to support an indie author, I would recommend this one. And look at the covers. I also gave 4 stars to The Dark Secret by Twee T. Sutherland. This is book 4 in the Wings of Fire series that I've been reading to my children. I really like this series. I think my least favorite was book 1. It was so violent. It was kind of a lot. But that tones down a bit later on in the series, and I see why these are so popular and continue to be so popular with young readers. They're really good. They explore difficult concepts and darker subject matter in a way that is age appropriate. They have wonderful character work and world building. I just really enjoyed it. This book in particular isn't my favorite of the series, but I think it's good. The big issue that this book is exploring with dragons is dehumanization and medical experimentation, and I think this does a really good job with it. It could be a really good jumping off point to discuss some of those things with kids. So 4 stars, still enjoying the Wings of Fire series. Just like getting through these quick. I got things to do, y'all. I also gave 4 stars to The Tower of Swallows by Andrzej Sapkowski. I read this for the Witcher read-along that me and Leanna have been doing over on Chapter 3 Podcast, and if you're interested in hearing us discuss it, I will link that video up above. We have a whole hour-long discussion of this book. I just continue to really enjoy this series. This book is really a coming-of-age story for Ciri. There is a lot of interesting stuff that happens, and the thing that me and Leanna, I think, both keep coming back to with this book is that things can be at once male-gazy and feminist, and I think that both of those things exist in the Witcher series, and it makes it really interesting to talk about. Anyway, I'm not going to get into it here. We talked a lot about it there, but I am enjoying these books. This one was 4 stars. Then I gave 4 stars to Thornhedge by T. Kingfisher. This is a novella that puts a really interesting spin on Sleeping Beauty, and it's short, so I don't really want to spoil it, but it really subverts your expectations with a fairy tale like that. And I think the tagline is like, "Not every curse should be broken." I think that's what it says on the front of the book. And it's pretty interesting. Also, the prince type character who comes along is Muslim, so that I think also adds an interesting element to the story. I liked this. I found this interesting and enjoyable. I won't say more about it because it's pretty short, but if you like T. Kingfisher, I think it's worth a read. My final 4-star read was Void by Veronica Roth. This is yet another of those short stories from that sci-fi collection, and I really liked this one. I thought it was interesting. It's kind of a different take on a sci-fi murder mystery, but set in space, and I think it plays with the dynamics of the world set up in some cool ways. It follows a woman who works on the janitorial staff of a spaceship that takes passengers traveling through the void, which is something outside of regular space-time, and a passenger is murdered and she's trying to investigate what happened and why. So yeah, I really liked this one. I thought it was cool. Moving right along, let's talk about my 4.5-star reads. This month there were 5 of them, and 2 of them I talked about in my mid-month wrap-up. Those books are Gathering Moss by Robin Wall Kimmerer and The Blood Gift by N.E. Davenport. So if you want to hear about either of those, go check out my mid-month wrap-up. I also gave 4.5 stars to Chioma, Curse of the Jangora, Volume 1, which is a pretty cool African-inspired epic medieval fantasy graphic novel. I really liked this a lot. This was sent to me for a sponsored video that I did promoting the Kickstarter for Volume 2. So if you saw my July book haul, you probably saw that. This video isn't sponsored. The review wasn't sponsored. They just wanted me to promote the Kickstarter, which is still ongoing. So I'm just going to go ahead and leave the link down below because I really want to see it succeed. I like what PETA Comics is doing. I think that they're telling some really cool African stories in comics. Some of them are more family friendly. This one is not family friendly. It's pretty violent, but it's really interesting, especially if you like politics and betrayal, badass warriors, including some women and magic. There's a lot going on, and like the artwork is just really high quality. Ashley at Bookish Realm has a fantastic full review of this, and she is much more an expert in this comics medium than I am, so maybe I'll link her video if you want to go and check it out, where she discusses this. It's phenomenal. So I highly recommend you go and check it out. They're doing a Kickstarter for volume 2. I want to see what's going to happen because this kind of leaves you on a cliffhanger where you're like, well, what's next? So hopefully we get volume 2 soon. And if you just want the digital version, you can support the Kickstarter for as little as $15. And I think for that, you get volumes 1 and 2 digitally. So go support a Black-owned indie comics company and, check out Chioma. That's my little plug. But I gave it 4.5 stars. I really liked it, and I will read on in the series when it's available. I also gave 4.5 stars to The Language of Thorns by Leigh Bardugo. I am so late reading this book. I've had it since it came out. I had this really lengthy sampler that included 2 full stories in it, so I had read those, and I just keep putting this off and putting this off. And I love it. I loved it. I mean, it is, number one, just a really beautiful book. The illustrations in it are gorgeous. But personally, I kind of think Leigh Bardugo is at her best in the short story form. I know that's not really what she's known for or what she writes the most of, but I think a lot of her best work is done in her short stories. And these are interesting because they draw a little bit on fairy tales that we know and love, like Hansel and Gretel, for instance, or, you know, whatever. There's several different ones. They don't retell them, but they take pieces of them and then tell these subversive, darker feminist stories that are asking difficult questions. And I really liked this collection a lot. So if you haven't already read them, I do recommend. The concept is that these are fairy tales from the Grishaverse. So there's some fun connections there if you are a fan of the Grishaverse, but I think these stand alone pretty well on their own as short stories. My final 4.5 star read was The Night Wanderer by Drew Hayden Taylor. This I had as an audio influencer copy from Libra FM. And I also read this as part of the All My Relatives Readathon hosted by Michelle at Thor Wants Another Letter. That I think was really cool, promoting reading books by Indigenous authors. So this is a paranormal coming of age story from an Indigenous author that puts a really interesting spin on a vampire story. It is partly the coming of age story of this teen girl who is dating a white boy who might not be everything that she thinks he is, and is struggling since her mom left their family for somebody else a year ago. She's living at home, and to make ends meet, her dad is making her move into the basement so that they can take on a boarder from Europe to help supplement their income. But that border might not be quite what he seems. I really liked this. I thought it was interesting. It was creepy without being too horrific. I think this would be a great pick for somebody who's a little bit of a wimp about horror but wants to dip their toes in the genre. This would be perfect for you. I really liked it. 4.5 stars. I hope we get more from this author too, because I think it's a debut novel. Next, let's talk about my 5-star reads. This month there were 10 of them, I believe, and 4 of them I talked about in my mid-month wrap-up. Those books are Freedom is a Constant Struggle, Ferguson, Palestine, and the Foundations of a Movement by Angela Davis, The Book of Gems by Fran Wild, The Center by Aisha Manazir Siddiqui, and Their Vicious Games by Joelle Wellington. If you want to hear about any of those, go check out my mid-month wrap-up. They were all great. I also gave 5 stars to Briar's book by Tamara Pierce. Is anyone surprised? No. All of these have been 5 stars for me on reread. They've been really fun. We had a really good conversation in our live show, which I can link up above if you want to go and check it out. I'm going to give a big content warning for it, that we talk a lot about COVID and trauma. So it's a pretty heavy conversation, at least for the first part of it. Although towards the end, it got a little bit more fun when we started fan casting the Circle of Magic series, if it was going to be a TV show. Because they should put these books back in print. They're so good. I had forgotten that this 4th book is about an epidemic, And it hit all of us really hard post-COVID. When I first read it, I remember it being interesting, but it didn't hit me in the same way. But yeah, like having been through an epidemic now, it's accurate and detailed and handled really, really well with a lot of care. Another reason we were saying, like, these books really should go back in print, especially after COVID. I think young people could use something like this to even help them process that experience. It's so good, though. I loved it. I also gave 5 stars to Curves for Days by Laura Moore. This is one, too, that's, like, on the edge of a 6-star for me, where it's possible if it sticks with me long enough, I may decide to upgrade it to a favorite of the year. But I would say this is definitely among my favorite romances that I've read. It's so good. And I will say I've been burned before with plus size body positive romances that didn't hit the way that I hoped they would. So I'm always a little tentative, but they had this as an audio review copy on NetGalley. So I was like, you know what, I'm gonna give it a try. And I loved it so much. And the thing is too, is that the main character, or the heroine at least, does go through a bit of a journey with her comfort level with her body, where she starts out being kind of uncomfortable, but she starts that journey to self-love before she gets with the hero, so it's not just him making her feel better about herself. And I just think it's handled so well and so beautifully, and he is never anything but enthralled with her, and he is also plus size, so this is great if you're looking for a plus size hero with a plus size heroine. It's a small town romance that's really cute. I think this could make a wonderful series, and it's just really sweet. It's this really sweet, beautiful romance that does have some steamier scenes, but the focus in those scenes is really about the couple and about their character and relationship development. I don't know if that makes sense. Like, the point of those scenes is less about the spiciness of them and more how it's moving forward the relationship, but also their own character development. And he is so sweet and gentle with her, especially because her only previous experience with sex had been one of trauma and assault. And so seeing the healing that comes from that is just really beautiful. I loved these characters so much. Maybe this should be 6 stars. I'm thinking about it. The basic premise of this is that she had been just really lonely and not in a great place when she unexpectedly wins the lottery, and then her life changes. So people suddenly want a relationship with her who didn't before, and she can't deal with it, so she decides to go by her middle name and leave town and find somewhere else to live and start over with all this money she now has. So she ends up in this small town, and she falls in love with it, and she buys a house, and she hires the hero, who is part-time a contractor, to help her renovate. But he's also a military veteran and works part-time as a therapist for military personnel. So this tackles a lot of difficult issues, but it does it with so much care and so beautifully. I just loved it a lot and highly recommend. My throat is starting to not like all the talking, so let's see if I can get through the rest of these books. There's some good ones. Next 5-star read is Just Out of Jupiter's Reach by Nnedi Okorafor. I think this is the last, of those sci-fi short stories. I always love Nnedi Okorafor. I just think she's so inventive and does really interesting things and packs so much into so few pages. Like, this is a pretty short story, but a level of world building and character development that she puts into it is just amazing. This follows a woman who is chosen to, like, genetically bond with a sentient spaceship along with other people who then travel to Jupiter. And I don't know, it's really about the characters. I loved it. I really enjoyed it. It was very delightful. I also gave 5 stars to Kushiel's Dart by Jacqueline Carey. What a pleasant surprise. I did not know how I was gonna do with this book. It's kind of notorious for having these like BDSM sex scenes in it. I really didn't know what to expect, but this book is so much more than that. I mean, yeah, it does have that, but really this is epic political fantasy as told through the perspective of a high-end sex worker, a religious high-end sex worker. And it is so good and so well executed. And the thing is that, like, while there are these difficult scenes and difficult elements to the world that she's created. It's by no means a utopia. I think you get to know the main character, Fedra, so well that you understand how she feels in these scenes and how they impact her, even if I might not feel the same way if I was in her place. And like, I was so enthralled with this, with the writing, with the story, with the characters. I was so invested, and it's not a short book, it's a long book. I loved it, and some of the relationships that she has are so beautiful. I don't know. I talked a lot about this in my Goodreads reviews. You can check that out, and I will have a reading vlog coming. I'm trying to finish reading Cassiel's Servant, which is the new book in the series that's coming out that is goes alongside this, but from Jocelyn's perspective, which so far I'm enjoying as well. But yeah, I'm really glad I read this at this point in my life. I think if I had read it a few years ago even, I would have struggled and mostly just been like shocked by some of the content. But now, yeah, it really resonated with me. So 5 stars. I didn't know what to expect, but I loved this. I think it's very well done. There are some difficult things though. So like, really do check my Goodreads review. I talk a little bit about some of the content warnings, because one thing about it is that they live in a world where there are rules about how old people have to be to enter into sex work, and it's like 15 or 16, but they do sexualize younger children than that in ways that are pretty uncomfortable. So like, I get it if this is something some people just can't read, but I did think it was done really well, especially for the time it was written in. In some ways, I think it was ahead of its time. Not in all ways. In some ways, it doesn't totally hold up, but I really loved it. I also gave 5 stars to Little Thieves by Margaret Owen, and patrons and channel members at the $5 a month level and above have access to a reading vlog for this. So this was a patron pick reading vlog for July, and I really loved it. This was on my radar mostly because of Rachel. It Reads with Rachel. And I don't know that it would have been otherwise. It's the kind of thing where I was like, reading the description, it sounds kind of like your basic YA fantasy, but it's not. It's so nuanced and well executed. The character work is really good. The world is really interesting. I don't think I am obsessed with it to the level that Rachel is, but I'm very impressed. I guess this is a kind of a retelling of the Goose Girl. It has a very traumatized and prickly heroine who I loved, and in a lot of ways this is a book about healing, difficult healing. There's magic, there's like, I don't know, there's a lot going on in this book, but it's very good. If you've been on the fence about it, I would recommend it. And my final 5-star read is another book that I got as a audio influencer copy from LibraFM, so thank you to them. This is Sipping Dom Perignon Through a Straw by Eddie Ndopu. This was phenomenal and very raw emotionally, but powerful, and I would definitely recommend it. It's a memoir written by a disabled queer Black man who is a disability activist, and this memoir is primarily about his experience being accepted into and attending Oxford and having to fight for the care that he required just to be able to do basic daily activities, and a lot of the horrific things that he went through in terms of care, but also how much he overcame and the things he's accomplished. And I just think that this is well worth a read. Everybody should probably read this. It is very vulnerable, the fact that he was willing to be so vulnerable about what he went through, and it is pretty horrific, some of it, and the fact that he was privately going through some of the stuff, like with care workers who did not take good care of him, medical challenges, the university not doing what they should have done, all the while excelling in graduate programs and doing everything he did. It's pretty amazing. So highly recommend, 5 stars, well worth a read. Lastly, this month I did have one book that got 6 stars, which is a favorite of the year, and I talked about it in my mid-month wrap-up. That book is Role Playing by Kathy Yardley. I loved this so much. One of my favorite romances. It's so good. Anyway, go check out that video if you want to hear my thoughts, but I was a fan, and if you are counting the books and noticed that I am one short, it is because the final book I read was a beta read, and I do not rate my beta reads. So, yeah, but that is my reading for July. Overall, I think it was a pretty good month. You know, some highs, some lows, but mostly positive. Talk to me in the comments down below. Let me know any of your thoughts or feelings on anything I talked about in this video. And for question of the day, okay, tell me about a book that arrived into your life at exactly the right moment. I love it when this happens, when like serendipitously you pick up a book at just the right time for where you are in your life. This is kind of how I feel about Kushiel's Dart, because it's been on my radar for years and I've kind of waffled on whether to read it. And I'm so glad that when I finally did, it was at a time when I could really love and appreciate it. So let me know if you've had something like that, a book that came into your life at the right time, in the comments down below. If you like this video, it always helps if you give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you want to see more. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.